Before we start the next episode, can I just give a quick shout out to John Adam Jackson on Facebook? He's created a lot of Facebook groups, which are all very interesting. And he's also been very kind in letting us promote this podcast on some of his various pages. He's built up quite a big community of interesting genres for all sorts of people who like this sort of thing. Channels I would highly recommend are The Nightmare Man from 1981 and Classic British Sci-fi, Fantasy and Horror. Another one of his is Emperor Palpatine, The Final Order. There's also movie soundtracks, classical music, metal, rock and other. There's quite a big list. So if you are looking for something to keep you entertained on Facebook, then please go to his various channels where there's always something for you to focus on and enjoy. So John, this show is dedicated to you, and thanks again for all your support.
Broadcasting from the depths of outer space.
Hello, I'm alive. I don't know what's going on.
By your command.
Fascinating.
God damn you all to hell!
This is the Sci-Fi Podcast.
This is episode 17 of the Solo One Sci-Fi Podcast. Mr. Michael Ball on the show today, and I can hear something. Is it a TARDIS? Who's coming out? It's Mr. Martin Fowler. Hello, Martin. How are you this week?
I'm going to stay quiet.
Why?
Because, again, you've like embarrassed me with these opening squeaking with drum roll.
Yeah,
and now it's
the TARDIS. Yeah, you love it. I don't know if I do this every week. It's just a short. I don't know whether.
Well, I need the creaking door effect.
Oh, I've done that. It's already added. So when I
you are clever. You are. Yeah,
of course I have. Yeah, so you stepped out. Yeah. There you go. Yeah, so when you had the pause, and then you had the creaking door. So don't even worry. I'll make sure I use my sound effects abilities to maximum here. How are you doing in London? I'm in Portsmouth, obviously. We are going to very, very briefly mention the coronavirus to say that it's obviously very bad for us both. But we're keeping indoors, we're keeping positive. And what we've decided is that we are going to keep discussion of this to the minimum. People know about this already. We all know it's shite. Let's talk about sci-fi, let's talk about news, and try to make the best of things. So is that all right with you, Martin?
Yeah, I feel like a prepper in America. That's all I'm going to say. I feel like I'm on one of them psychological experiments in a 70s sci-fi movie, living in a room on my own, and I'm being watched by 1 million people, and I don't know what's going on.
I feel like I'm a bit like in Cube, where I'm in that one room, and like you can't get out, except the hatches in my cube don't work. The hatches are sealed shut. So there we go.
Yeah,
and it's just me. I'm in bloody Cube. Yeah, so that's it. Yeah. How did they get food in Cube? I can't remember. How did they eat in Cube?
I don't know. Didn't they make about 3 films, though?
Yeah, they did. I've got them all.
I saw the first, second one.
Yeah, and I think the last one was a prequel, I think. But I just thinking about
was it.
Yeah, but I can't remember. Did they eat in Cube? How did they go to the toilet? I've just suddenly thought about
that.
Because they're
don't
in there.
About them.
No, I know, but I just suddenly thought of that.
In science fiction, nobody goes to the toilet. I came up with something interesting the other day. When Luke Skywalker is in an X-wing, right?
Oh,
flying from
maybe he's got a commode.
To the other.
Oh yes. How does
and
he take a dump?
5 days to get there, and he's in an X-wing. Well, how does he have a shit and wee?
Well, no, he must.
Does the X-wing have a toilet?
No, it's a commode. His toilet, his seat is a commode. So he sits there, and he sits there. No, he must be in the X-Wing with no trousers on, or he's got his trousers down, and he flies, talks to R2-D2, and pinches a loaf.
So you're telling me that Luke Skywalker sits when he's going on a 5-day trip from one planet to the next one,
right?
He'd
have to,
he's got a piss bottle, and then he lifts up the seat in the X-Wing and has a shit.
Well, I think he just sits there the whole time, because how can he can't really get up out of his seat, can he?
There.
Yeah, but,
it'd
I mean...
stink.
Well, R2-D2 couldn't smell it. He's out in space, isn't he?
And
he won't smell it. I mell it. I mean, we won't smell it because there's no smell-o-vision on film. So he's probably reeks in there. But you know how, like, when you go... thing is, when you go and you make the smell, it doesn't smell so bad. But when you leave the bathroom and then you come back in, it smells terrible.
Yes.
Have you ever wondered that? So maybe it's the same in the next wing.
Oh, let's get on with the show. I'm not throwing no more logical, sensible questions to you.
No, I don't know how on earth we started off this show talking about X-Wing commodes and stuff, but there we go. It was. And like I said, we have seen our first official toilet. We saw in episode one of The Mandalorian. We did see a toilet in there.
Yeah, we did.
That was the very first.
But that's the big shit.
Yes, it was. But that's the first ever canon toilet in the Star Wars franchise. We've still not seen one in Star Trek, although the Enterprise D did have a bathroom at the back on the left-hand side.
Yeah, well, yeah, but they are people vacuuming the bloody carpets on the Enterprise.
Oh, no, I heard that the actual Enterprise has, like, some nanobots or something which cleans the carpet automatically.
Well, there is some clips of a dude in a hallway in one of the corridors vacuuming the carpet.
Oh, was there? Oh, I didn't miss that now.
He's sliding something along the carpet. I assume it's a fucking vacuum cleaner.
Oh, God, that's why he's so sliding across the carpet. I don't know. Okay. I have no idea. Anyway, today's show we are going to focus on Doctor Who, and we've decided... I've decided, and Marty said, oh, go on then. We're going to do Colin Baker, the Sixth Doctor. I like that. I know, this is going to be interesting, because I actually liked his era, and the 80s were my favourite era of Doctor Who, probably. So I want to bounce off you, what you thought about it, first impressions. We'll do that in the Solo Sci-Fi Focus of the Week. Let's quickly go into Solo Sci-Fi News. There's not much, but let's just give this jingle a play and see where we go from here. Here we go.
Solo Sci-Fi News.
Okay, so this week, understandably, we have not got much news at all, but we can talk about shows which are obviously still being shown because they've not been completed. So probably the biggest focus of the week for me, news-wise, was episode 9 of Star Trek Picard. Now, this episode, from what I've gathered, has had a very kind of... It's sort of split the opinion of fans. I liked this episode a lot. I actually thought it was really quite good. But then when I went to some of the regular YouTube channels, they were saying, oh, it's not good. And well, tell me what you thought about it, first of all, because you're more of a fan of Picard than I am at the moment.
This week's episode, there was a lot of answers, but really not much going on.
Yeah. But, I mean, we need to sort of... I mean, this is a spoiler, so if you haven't seen it, obviously watch it first. Now, of course, first of all, the most interesting thing is now we've discovered that Noonien Sung, who, of course, created Data, has had a son. Now, somewhere they say... Now, I didn't pick up on this, that apparently, in canon, Noonien Sung was not supposed to have had a son. That is why he created Data.
No, he didn't.
But did they say that, actually, in an episode, that he didn't have children?
Yeah, he did. That's why he created Laura and Data. He had no children.
So, how do you feel about this additional Sung? Is it, because some people are thinking that this if it is Sung's son, it isn't actually. It might be a biological version of Law.
I think we've had a clue already because of the body in the cylinder.
Oh, right. Okay. Oh, so no, what do you think?
I think it's Law.
You think it's Law? Because
it could be Law or Noonien Sung. Also, they made another fuck up as well, because there's an episode in Next Generation where they needed what they call it, Maddox,
Bruce Maddox,
mind transfer.
Yeah,
but there was an episode at Next Gen where some scientist died and transferred his consciousness into Data.
Oh, Grandpa, the one that called Data. He was, with that actor who has been in lots of shows, and it was a season 2 episode. Yes. What's the Measure of a Man? I know the episode, I can't think of his name, but he did. And in the end of the episode, the actual scientist died and transferred his essence or his thoughts into Data, and Data had a sort of schizophrenic kind of thing where he was slowly becoming less Data and more like this scientist. So you're right, that has already been confirmed in canon, but in this new series they're saying that's never happened. Is that what they're saying? They're not.
Well,
though,
they say a lot of things never bloody happened, aren't they? I mean, you know, we're ardent viewers of this stuff, and we like canon, don't we?
Yeah,
we
do. We do. I mean, it's very important.
I do. I think it is important. And, well, maybe they deleted, maybe all the thing were deleted, you know, maybe deleted it, I don't know. But there's something to do with that cylinder of that body in there. That could be Data being recreated, or it's Law who's made him, who's disguised himself.
Yeah, it could be.
And who was the telepathic message through Picard as well?
Now we heard that there apparently is some huge other federation of synthetic life which spans galaxies and it's really powerful. We don't know much about them, but do you think they're going to make an appearance in the last episode? What do you think of your predictions?
You mean the Cylons?
No, maybe next week. No, maybe next season. No, do you remember they mentioned there was... It could be. There are some parallels with the new Battlestar Galactica actually, thinking about it, actually.
Go on.
No. But what do you think will happen in the last episode? What's the big revelation?
I think this week's episode is going to be action-packed, right?
Like the last episode of Discovery.
It's going to be moving. We're going to get revelations and big things. And then the Starfleet's going to turn up. They're holding that back. A big squadron of starships. They're either going to team up with Romulans or they're going to go toe-to-toe. She's going to get the Borg cube up and running.
Yeah, I think that's going
to
happen.
The planet. The synthetics are going to turn up. And rumour has it Q's going to pop up.
I heard of that. Do you know what I'm doing, though?
That's
I don't know if I mentioned this last week, but in the beginning of the opening credits, when you actually see... I like the opening credits, but it keeps giving spoilers away. It keeps saying the actors that are going to appear in the episode. And last week it said a special guest star, Brent Spiner, and then before it's had Jerry Ryan. And you know who's... And I want surprises. So when the credits come on for the last episode, I'm not looking at the credits. I'm going to zip forward. Because they keep giving... They might suddenly say special guest star John Delancey will be on, and then it's going to ruin it for everybody. So I'm not going to do that this week. I was sport last week. Although I thought Data or Brent Spiner would be involved. And of course, you didn't know the character he's going to play. But I just don't want to know who's guest starring until I've seen the episode for the first time round.
Well, I'll tell you something. In that Sung family, they all look alike, don't they?
Yes, they do.
I mean, you go back to Enterprise. You were messing around genetic humans.
That's right. I know, and it's funny how they all look the same. I didn't mind that, actually, because it's a way to get Brent Spiner back. And they've already done it with Arik Sung, and of course we've seen Noonien Sung, and now we've seen this other Sung. I can't remember his first name. I don't mind it. It's a bit of a stretch, but that particular aspect I'm not that bothered about. Some people are hacked off about it, but I can live with it, because you're seeing Brent Spiner back in Star Trek, so I can live with that.
I've got just come in now. A friend sent it about Section 31 news.
Oh, okay. Bring it on. If it's breaking news.
On my live stream, just sent me Spacecom. Space.com says Section 31 will revolve around a secret, super secret Federation intelligence organization that exists in the Mirror Universe, first introduced to fans. In season 2 of E4, the original series, Trekkies might remember Captain Kirk was accidentally beamed into this alternative reality following a transport hiccup. It's what he sent.
Right.
So they said, and I have got, I'll mention it about Enterprise and what they were going to originally do in the Mirror Universe.
Oh, okay. What were they going to do? Is this something I'm not aware of?
Oh, right. Yeah, you remember when they did Mirror Darkly?
Yeah, which I loved it. It was my favourite two-parter.
Well, they wanted William Shatner to be in it.
I know, I heard about Captain that. Kirk. I did hear about that. They didn't offer him enough money, apparently.
Well, the story, you know the Tantalus field? You know that Tantalus field where he got rid of people?
Yes.
You know why he got rid of people? Just disappeared with cheesy effects.
Yes.
Well, they're not dead. They go somewhere. They go somewhere, right?
Oh.
And there's no time. So they end up in this place where they're all trapped there, all these people.
Right.
And it's this planet, but there's no time there. And Enterprise turns up and he meets William Shatner, Captain Kirk, as Archer. But somehow he escapes at the end. He goes back into the past to create the Empire or something like that. It's ridiculous.
Oh,
it's something I remember reading about. It sounded quite interesting.
Yeah.
Oh, he gets back to his own universe. But they did do it, so.
Okay. Well, like I said, it's interesting. I mean, I think that two-parter was excellent.
I heard that.
I thought it was really good, and of course it fitted with canon. We saw the what was the Mirror Universe?
Not Defiant.
Defiant. We saw the Defiant. I should remember that. And it, of course, it explained what happened. It was literally a sequel and a prequel. It was a sequel to the Tholian Web from the original series, and it was also a prequel because it was the Mirror Universe before we saw them in the Mirror. It was brilliant. It was the cast were all over the top a bit, but that's fine because it's the Mirror Universe. Going back to the Section 31 series, it's probably a series. There goes your phone. But you just don't stop.
I'll phone them back in a minute. Right,
that's no problem. The Section 31 series, the series I want is the Star Trek Pike series. Christopher Pike series. I want a series where it can have a running arc and it can just literally be, it will be Anson Mount will be back as Pike and all the others as well, who I'm quite happy with. There it goes again.
Hang on. I'll take this. Hello? Yeah, I'm doing a podcast. Can I phone you back in about 45 minutes? Yeah. All right, I'll phone you in 40 minutes, yeah? All right, take care. Bye.
There we go. A bit of live communications from out there somewhere for my co-host.
I know. Every time I watch Bloody Doctor Who, somebody phone me up. I'm sure there's a conspiracy going on.
Maybe they know that you're a fan and they actually ring you up just to wind you up or something because they know you're moving.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Anyway, so. Going back to Section 31. So. How do you feel about this potential new series? It started to go ahead. Are you looking forward to it? Are you a bit meh? What do you think about it?
Well, I'm more interested in. Well, look, I like Michelle Yeoh, she's a superb actress, and I like the concept of Section 31. I like the Federation to have some kind of dirt to it.
Yeah, which has always been which has been established since DS9 with Section 31.
Yeah, I mean, if you've got Tal Shiar and Obsidian Order, you're gonna have within
exactly. Yeah, although Outland,
I'm open to it.
Although, of course, the Federation's one. I mean, the Tal Shiar and the Obsidian Order, they weren't secret, were they? I mean, they were known, weren't they, to their own respective empires?
They were known, but Section 31 is Starfleet intelligent.
So Starfleet intelligent.
But that was way above it.
Yeah. But I mean, was Starfleet intelligent though? Was that the same as the Obsidian Order, or is Section 31 more like the Obsidian Order?
I suppose that Starfleet intelligence were like, I'd say like, well, they were like sort of like not the FBI. They were like a standard. They defended the Federation. They had standard top secret operation. But then they went by rules. They were a bit more decent. But doing the dirty business, like assassinations, manipulations, putting plants in, is Section 31's job. I always liked the Pegasus episode with Riker.
Yes.
That was the Section 31, because they said there's some people watching this very high up.
Joe! I've never connected that.
I'm not saying that.
It must have been. I mean, technically, Section 31 was invented by the makers in season six, I think it was,
yeah,
of DS9, yeah. Maybe six, season five, and that was obviously probably quite a few years after the Pegasus, which is season seven of TNG. But it fits perfectly with that.
Yeah, that's only me saying that.
No,
I'm
I know,
sad,
but
I think.
But it fits. It works. I can see that definitely working.
Well, the Treaty of Algeron said that to keep peace with the Romulans, they were not allowed to pursue cloaking technology of any kind.
That's right.
But who would Starfleet intelligence probably wouldn't do that because they've got to answer to the Joint Chiefs of Admirals. But within them admirals, there'd be one or two that answer to somebody
Section
very
31.
High up
in the background, which of course is Section 31.
Yeah.
Oh, That makes. I mean, I know that you just thought of it, but that to me, as far as I'm concerned, that's given. I couldn't agree with that scenario or observation more. This completely fits in with Section 31, with them running in the background, with them looking for a way to defeat and help protect the Federation with stuff which is down and dirty and stuff that the normal Federation would not condone. Yeah, that makes perfect sense to me. I think that's excellent. So, let's go with it. Section 31, that's going to be interesting. I will certainly watch it.
it. Of course, I hope that Patrick Stewart can return soon to film season 2 of Picard, although some people are saying he might even be killed off in the next episode. So it could be like Picard's legacy, where he started off with him and then it follows. But I don't know whether that's true or not.
I don't think it'd work without him. If they did that at the end of this, I don't think it'd work, because it's about him.
It's about
him. The glue. But
yeah.
Without him, what's the point of the others, really?
Yeah, but of course, I mean, the actor's very old, and of course, we're all worried about our health and stuff. So I just hope that he can just, I assume that Picard was going to be shown early next year, but God knows when that's going to be made now. But at least Discovery, as far as I know, it's still on very soon. So we're going to have some new Star Trek to talk about soon with
Discovery.
Well,
it's rumoured that might be put back.
Oh, what, the actual transmission?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
It might be on Facebook.
So what did you read?
Because of this coronavirus, it said it might still. I thought it were done, but there might be some post-production stuff to do.
Do that in their own? I mean, it's all online. Can't you just do it on your computer and do all the? I mean,
well, that's what I thought. Yeah.
And you know, I would have thought if they do 10 episodes or 13, I don't know how many episodes they're doing this season. They would still have time to do the latter parts of the episodes.
Yeah.
Let's just see what happens. I mean, I'll check one or two sites to look at, which I think one's called Trek World. It gives you news and stuff like that. So, I hope not. We have got new Red Dwarf coming in about 2 weeks' time, which I'm looking forward to. We can have a big discussion about that. But, let's just see what happens with that. So, other news. Any other news that you come across that you want to share with the world?
Michael Payne, big fan. Loved him as Hicks in Aliens and Kyle Reese.
Yes.
The original Kyle Reese. Brilliant, he's going to be in The Mandalorian. And is it Rosario Dawson? The fan base, a lot of fans have been having a go at her, apparently.
Why?
Because apparently she said something political.
Oh, God. What, she made some sort of slip-up or something, did she?
No, she said something. I don't want to go. I'll tell you. Well,
tell
she said something. I don't know, some people got funny about it. Geeks and gamers have been attacking them.
Okay.
It just, she had, look, I'll tell you off it. I don't want to get into
that's fine.
But a lot of people are quite excited about it, but it's like there's a certain section that are happy about it, and it's up to, I don't think she said it bad personally, but some people, I mean, I'm not going into all that.
I know you always say out the P word. I know you do that on your show. That's fine.
I'll tell you after this. But she's great. She were in Daredevil, and
I've not seen her in anything that she's made. So, but if you're giving me the thumbs up, that's good.
Ahsoka Tano is an amazing character from the Star Wars series.
Well, I'll have time to watch it. I mean, they're showing season 7, and of course, I've got the whole lot to watch.
Can I just say, I was online yesterday, and I didn't realise it said the advert came up for Disney Plus, right?
Yeah.
And I sat there looking at it, I thought, right. And then I thought, oh, yeah, season 7 at Clone Wars. I thought, right, yeah, that's good.
Oh.
So I went on to that website and I thought, well, go on, I'll pay it then. I thought I'd buy it for a year.
Yeah.
Instead of the £5.99 a month, you know. So I bought it for a year. There were only 2 bloody episodes.
Oh, you're kidding. Oh, no.
Well, yeah. I thought they'd put the whole lot up.
I mean, I'm not condoning, but I think that people could know that if you look around hard enough online, you can find copies.
Oh, that's naughty.
I know it is. I'm not saying
it's
that you should.
Naughty,
I'm just saying. I'm just saying. I'm not
okay,
saying.
Okay.
I'm not
right,
saying that we are, but I'm just saying that some people could do it that way. If Disney, I mean, the thing is that The Mandalorian. I mean, that was been viewed by so many people so long before it could actually be accessible. From the Disney site, because like I said, they took too long to release it, I think.
Yeah, but not all the episodes of Mandalorian are on. They're still releasing them each week because, you know, they've got the Brit, and I've seen the whole bloody series last year.
But it's been out, I mean, it was out about 3 months ago, and you're saying the whole lot's not on this Disney thing, which you're all paying for?
I don't think it is, no.
Oh,
a couple of people said there's only a couple. It's been shown in America, but the Disney Plus started here. I mean, I went through it yesterday. There's a lot on there to watch. I didn't even know they owned the National, what is it? National Geographic Channel. Didn't know Disney owned that.
So what do you recommend on their channel? What's worth
checking out? There's a lot of Marvel stuff. Obviously, there's all Disney stuff. But there's like comedies and Pixar movies. And
what sort of comedy?
A lot on them.
What sort of comedies have they got?
Boy Meets World and stuff like that.
Oh, I never heard of that. No, I like old comedies.
No, I know of it. I've not bothered. But there's a lot of Marvels, like Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., Inhumans, and...
Yeah, we see, I'm not into it.
I paid £50 for 12 months, which I thought it was this offer, and I thought, go on then. Because I don't know how long I'm going to be in house for.
Well, yeah, that's what I'm saying. Actually, they'll probably do good, because Netflix and all this lot, you can't watch live TV, there's nothing on. Netflix is... I love Netflix. I don't watch it, because I'm always doing... other things. It's amazing. I'm only watching maybe a couple of hours of TV per day. I'm either doing graphic design work, sound editing, doing the podcast, doing YouTube, it's amazing, yeah. Actually. I don't watch a lot of TV.
With Netflix and Amazon, I just float in for specific things.
Yeah.
Like, say if Lucifer starts tomorrow, I'll go in and watch it. Or I'll go into Netflix, say, when Summit News on, I don't sit there all day trolling through it.
No,
because I've got to say, on both of them, it's 90% of it is crap.
Well, but, yeah.
For £6 a month, you're not going to complain.
No, and it's a lot better than live TV, BBC and RTV and all the crud that they put
on. And if you think about how much money do you spend on Blu-rays per month?
Yeah, exactly. It makes it well worth...
£50. No, you're going to probably spend that. You say you buy Star Wars out next week and you bought Terminator Doubt, that's 20, 30 quid.
Yeah,
it
soon mounts up. Exactly. And back to the cinema, you wonder whether... the films I'm looking forward to this year are the new Ghostbusters, which will be interesting.
I thought you were a bit wary about that last time we talked about that.
I'm just still looking forward to it.
The
thing is, you see, I've got mixed feelings because I know that the original cast are in it, but it also does look like it features a lot of kids in it. So it does, from first impressions from the trailer, have a slightly Goonies kind of feel to it. So I don't know. I've got mixed feelings. I didn't like the recent one with the women Ghostbusters one. I thought that was pretty bad. Did you like that one?
I've got to admit, I panned it with the trailer. I thought the trailer were terrible.
Right.
But I did go see it. And I'll probably get shot down for this, but I've got to say it wasn't that bad. It could have been better.
Yeah.
They went the wrong way about it. They really did. But the script, I read the script before I went to see it. It was released online, and it was identical. And it was all right, but they've got to get off this thing now. You know, two men and two women would have just worked just as good.
Yeah.
We need to get off this thing and just create science fiction, this identity.
Yeah, because it's all politics, politically motivated. Yeah. It's like Bill and Ted's are back with another excellent adventure this time. But of course, they've got two daughters this time round. So, again, you don't know quite what to expect from that.
I don't think I'm going to bother with that. I just know it's going to be fucked up. I just know it is.
Do you think? You might be right.
Yeah,
I don't know.
I do. Because I've sat through rehashes over the last few years, and they've... And sorry for swearing, but they've gone and fucked up so much stuff. They have. The Ghostbusters should have been good. It's not a bad film, to be honest. But the politics around it and the rest of it, it kills it for me. I just want to watch something. I don't mind messages being in there, but do it in the science fiction way, so that when you leave the cinema, you're thinking about it, not going, oh God, that were a bit too much, that was patronizing. Do you know what I mean?
It is a bit patronizing, and it's so in your face with these politically motivated and also PC-isms and stuff like that, just because it's almost expected. And it's like, I was quite surprised. I gave The Last Star Wars a watch again, and at the end, when they're all celebrating, I saw two women kissing in the background. Did you see that? Yeah.
When did that?
Yeah, it did. At the end. No, I know. What? And I thought, okay. And of course, They had the very first gay kiss on Star Wars, and I thought,
well
it was near the end. It was in the end when you had, you know, the guy that was on Lost, the guy that was the
and
he was there, and they were all celebrating, and he also had the, because Prince what's this? Carrie Fisher's daughter was in Star Wars 9 as one of the rebellion. And it was near them. It wasn't her, but it was two women. They sort of run to each other and give each other a big snog, or a big kiss on the lips. It wasn't too in your face, but I thought,
well, I did.
I didn't see it the first time. I was just a bit surprised.
It's all right.
You might have enjoyed it, but
yeah.
He's gonna watch it. Well, anyway, going back. I know. Oh no, don't. That's it now. He's getting his pause button ready.
Why can't they just do stuff like a story and make things? You know, fucking Star Wars was Star Wars and keep it at that. Look, it's good versus evil. It's good. It's the few take on the monolithic, greedy, nasty, cruel empire. Yeah. We like that.
Yeah, of course we do.
We like that, but don't bring the fucking politics into each character.
With that it was minimal. It was minimal, and I still like the last Star Wars film. I don't care. I just think it's a good film.
I liked it. And
The Mandalorian, that just feels like a Star Wars story. It doesn't have any PC-isms in it too much. It's just this character looking after this baby, and it's just, I love that series. I keep thinking about it.
I think for me the best Star Wars film's Rogue One, and
I love
the
Rogue
Mandalorian
One.
Is just so connected to that.
Oh my god, I know it is. And there's gonna be another series which features the Rogue One character, isn't there? Apparently.
I forgot about that.
The Spanish character. I can't remember his name. The one that died at the end.
It was depressing, that ending, wasn't it? There's so many folks going to come down and
everything.
Save them.
I know. I loved it. That film, actually, I might have to watch that again this afternoon. I cannot praise Star Wars enough, what they've done. I think that, they've done one or two hiccups. I thought I was a bit underwhelmed with Solo and The Last Jedi.
I don't know.
I think I saw it after The Last Jedi, which really went down like a lead balloon.
That killed it. I think Last Jedi murdered that film.
Yeah, I do too.
It
was a shockwave, and it was released too soon after. Was it Rian Johnson who did The Last Jedi and the one that messed it all up? I think it was him.
I think they'd have him nailed to
one. Oh, I know. Originally they were going to do three more new Star Wars films based on one of his concepts, and of course that's all gone. But anyway, Star Wars, thumbs up. Star Trek is okay at the moment. Picard, I like, although I think the story has been a bit too long and a bit too drawn out for me, at least. I want to see. I think next episode, the season finale, will be like the season 2 finale of Discovery, where it'll be all ship battles and explosions. Can we please see a Federation starship? Just one Federation starship, please. You know, every Star Trek series...
We're
going to
see a squadron of them this week.
I know, but what if it's all Discovery ships or something like that? I'm a ship guy.
No,
because
they've got the rights back now.
I did wonder that, because when they would have made that last episode, then the Paramount-CBS merger would have gone ahead. So, yes. And technically, we did see the Enterprise-D already.
Well, I know Worf's he's the captain of the Enterprise, but I bet it's Riker leading squadron.
Oh, well, I don't know. I just hope so. It's only got 2 days to wait from my perspective, so I really can't wait to see, and we'll have a big chat about that. Now, let's, anything else about the news before we move on to our folks of the week?
No, I think we've covered everything. I mean, we might as well. I don't think there's going to be any sci-fi news coming. You know, I mean, I don't know. I think, what do we do after Red 12?
That's a good point, actually. I mean, we talk about... Yeah. We've got Star Trek next week, Picard. Then it'll be soon to Red Dwarf. We might need to do slightly different focus of the week, or maybe... I don't know. less, or it might, maybe our shows might be a little bit shorter for a little while, but if they are, then of course we apologise, but then there are limitations to what we can do.
There'll be something out there, there'll be something to moan about, there will be, and complain and have a go at and be happy about. There'll be something. I've got faith, I'm an optimist.
Or maybe we could do like a new topic, like Sci-Fi Grudge, where we focus on one aspect of a show that's always annoyed us.
Yeah, oh, I like that.
Solar Sci-Fi Grudge.
Yes.
Oh.
Yes.
And so we could do that. And we could,
this week.
Yeah, and then we could. I could do a silly jingle or something. And then
yes,
we could,
I like
and
that, yeah.
So that's. Let's see, we're talking about stuff as we're recording. So she's quite creative.
Yeah.
Right, here we go. Solar Sci-Fi Focus of the Week. Here we go.
It's the Solar Sci-Fi Focus of the Week.
All right, so this week is our very first focus on, of course, the most iconic British science fiction series ever, which, of course, being Doctor Who. We had the idea that because Doctor Who is such a rich tapestry of science fiction and everything else, that we should focus every time we go to Doctor Who on a particular Doctor. And we decided, I guess because I run the show, that we would focus this time on the sixth Doctor, Mr. Colin Baker, who was on the show from 1984 to 1986, in a very upheaval kind of period in the Doctor Who saga with regard to things running in the background. And it also had Michael Grade, BBC chief executive, who had his dagger in ready for the show. So let's ask you, first of all, what did you think about Colin Baker? I already know, but people don't know so much. Tell me what you thought, and let's go from there.
What, Colin Baker?
Your voice has already gone very low, very slow. Go on.
I think that was the time I've seen all his episodes. There is one or two days. Someone's in there. I remember I bought the Trial of a Time Lord on VHS in that box set when it came out.
Right.
And it was just fucking ridiculous. I mean, I like the Volgata, I like the concept, I like the final part of it, but the attack of the Vervoids, oh, for God's sake.
Oh, the plant people.
Oh, come on. Yeah, I mean, come on.
Well, they were the Doctor Who Triffids, weren't they, really?
Yeah, they were just, oh, man, fucking. And look how he dressed up in that. Idiot.
Yeah, but I know the actor hated it. I know that he originally wanted to wear some...
Yeah, but who designed that?
Yeah, well, they wanted to make him really... I mean, the thing is, you see, the reason why I defend the Doctor, this Doctor, is that I think, and I've always said this, that his regeneration from Peter Davison, it went slightly wrong. And that's why, although he was the next Doctor, something in the regeneration had gone wrong and he made him unstable. And especially in those early episodes where he tried to strangle Perry and things like that. And I actually like the idea that him being slightly defective. I mean, in consequence, the regeneration is every cell of the body sort of exploding, then re-imploding, and then kind of sorting itself out. It's like mixing everything up, shaking everything up. But what if regeneration can sometimes be dangerous or go slightly wrong? Like some disability kind of thing. And so he emerged as the next Doctor, but it's something in his psyche was wrong. And I just, for me, I found that quite compelling. I found that quite interesting.
And that's what you're going to use to defend that, then?
Yeah. Yeah, I might as well. Yeah, why not? I'm going to go for it.
I'm shocked. You've absolutely stunned me today with that.
Have I?
Yeah, you have. It was terrible. It was that coat, the stupid cat badge, all of it, that idiot's coat. I went to a convention. I'm at a group of them all dressed like that.
Okay.
There were about eight of them all dressed identical to that. Right. And I said, I want to shoot them all.
So was it partly just his dress sense that really alienated you from his particular character?
I just didn't. It was just idiots. They looked like he'd escaped from the asylum. He did. He'd running around England dressed like that. He just, I couldn't stand. Look, he had a few decent episodes and his audio adventures are very good.
Right.
I don't think he got a fair chance of it.
Oh, he
did. I really don't.
He didn't.
And I don't think it were fair to him. But, you know, that suit, what he had on, was ridiculous. And to me, I don't know. I just, the most 80%, I'll probably get shot down for, I'm just not a fan of Colin Baker years at all. There is one or two decent episodes. The one with the Cybermen I thought was brilliant. And
I love that episode. And
the Dalek one was sort of weird with Alexis Sale, the DJ.
I thought that was quite cool. I liked it.
I thought it was exemplary, that episode. I really did like it.
Yeah, I did as well. It's strange, though, because, as you say, I mean, I also like Vengeance on Varos, which is very good as well. I thought that was a very good episode.
I couldn't do without Syl. Oh, God, it used to freak me out.
Oh, Syl was cool. I thought Syl was really good. Did you not like Syl?
No, it was a slimy, oh, it was a putrid-looking thing, that one.
La 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 la.
Can you do remember his boss? Well, do you remember his boss?
His boss? Yeah, he had...
There were that brown one, and they were going to put his brain in Perry's head.
Yes, and then Perry... Well, we thought that Perry's brain was removed and that his boss got put in Perry's body, didn't we?
Yeah, that's it, yeah.
I just thought it was really cool.
There is, I mean, I do like Trial of a Time Lord. I like the final part of it when they're running around in the Matrix. And the concepts of the Valyard was awesome.
Yeah, which was in between the 12th and final regeneration. So technically was the essence of partly Matt Smith and partly Peter Capaldi, I think. Is that right? You're right, because of the War Doctor. So it would be... It's partly David Tennant and partly Matt Smith then, because Matt Smith...
So how far down the line is the Valyard then, since there's no limit to regenerations then?
Well, at that point, see, this is a discontinuity, because at that point, from what we understood, the Doctor did have the regeneration limits, although but whether he originally was this creature that could regenerate indefinitely, and the Time Lords somehow put a clamp down and locked him into the regeneration limit of the 12 regeneration limits. Well, that explain why the Matt Smith Doctor was dying at the end, because he ran out of regenerations. I don't know. It's an interesting one. But like I said, I was just looking at some of the episodes, actually, episode guide. Let's see what other episodes. So let's quickly go. So it did start off to a very bad start with the Twin Dilemma, which was a poor episode, which came straight after The Caves of Androzani, which is regarded as one of the best episodes ever of Doctor Who. Yeah, it's regarded as a classic. And it was a very, very good Fifth Doctor last episode.
Yes.
So you had the Twin Dilemma. Although we did have another Time Lord in that episode, so it wasn't all bad. Attack of the Cybermen, you already mentioned, which I thought was very good. Vengeance on Varos, I thought was also a good one, with people voting on their TVs and all that sort of stuff. And I thought that was good.
Yes.
Next one was The Mark of the Rani. Which was interesting, because the Rani was really just like another sort of female master, wasn't she, really?
Wasn't that the one where they were in industrial Britain?
Yeah, coal. It's like Yorkshire. Oh,
yeah.
And there was like a coal mining town and stuff, and she was controlling, she was trying to take the essence out of some of the workers or something, and they had these sort of big yellow, big sort of orange spots on their neck or something, and then she could kill. And so that I thought that was all right, that one. I thought that was quite good.
Yeah, no, I enjoyed that.
The Two Doctors, I thought was good. I like that race of that, like, they look like human, but they're like cannibals, and all they wanted to do was eat
the Androgens.
And they wanted to eat Jamie, didn't they? And it was nice to see the Second Doctor, his last appearance in Doctor Who, with Jamie.
Supreme Commander Servalan,
of course, from Blake 7. She was good in that character as well. And the next episode was Time Lash, which I don't think that was a very good one. I don't remember much about that one.
Explain Time Lash. Is that
Time Lash? I'm trying to remember.
Time Lash, the one with the Concorde?
No, that was Time Flight.
Okay, so all right.
That was Time Flight.
I don't remember it.
No, that wasn't a very good one. They had androids in it, and it had this weird portal, and I don't remember. That was a weak one. Oh, it had another character from Blake 7 in it. It had the, what's his name?
Avon.
Avon. I think he was in that episode.
Right.
So you had two consecutive episodes.
He was in that. I'm getting a memory flash of that now.
Yeah, so Avon the actor was in that episode. Yeah. Then we had, Revelation of the Daleks with the disco guy. What's his name? Alex Isell, which is good. I like that one. Then we had the four...
I'm a big fan of that. Very weird episode.
But it set up for this two factions of the Daleks as well, which I thought was quite interesting, which followed up with the next Doctor as well. And then, of course, we had the Trial of the Time Lord 13-parter, which I actually thought was good. It could have just been standalone episodes, and we could have just had the last two episodes as the Trial of the Time Lord.
I like the old thing where they found out he was on Earth in the future and they were all living underground serving that
robot. That was the mysterious planet, which was, and they thought they were on a different planet. Ravox or Ravalox, I think it was.
Ravalox, yes.
God, how did I remember that? Ravalox, I think it was. Sablon Glitz, who was good and appeared. He returned in the next Doctor story as well. Sablon Glitz was good. I think one aspect I couldn't stand at this period, and it got carried over to the Seventh Doctor, who I wasn't a big fan of, was the awful Mel screaming her head off.
And scream until I'm sick.
She drove me nuts. She's one of my least favourite ever companions.
I used to fancy her, you know.
Oh, no.
I did Bonnie Langford. She looked better
actually when she was a bit older, I thought, to me. But
I agree.
I didn't like her at this point. I mean, she just drove me nuts.
But don't you remember that episode where you had Kate O'Mara running around, like, dressed up as Bonnie bloody Langford?
Yeah, that was the first episode of the Seventh Doctor.
Yeah, it was. That was terrible.
That was Time in the Rani, I think it was called. That was awful. And that really got the Seventh Doctor. We won't talk about him this episode, but I want to talk about him. But go back to the Sixth. So it was a mixed bag. I mean, you've got to give some credit to the fact that they did their best. They had an executive in charge of BBC who loathed the series. Apparently, didn't Colin Baker have a relationship with something to do with Michael Grain's wife or something? I think there was something.
I didn't know that.
I don't know. I'm just desperately trying to find it.
I read that Greg didn't like science fiction at all.
I'm just trying to Google it while I'm talking, but there was something I read about Michael Grade. I'm just trying to put
it
in. Michael Grade.
So Colin Baker might have been taking her for trips in the TARDIS then.
Well, come and see what's in my...
Showing her the old tonic.
Yeah, I'm going to show you my box. Yeah, Michael Grade, Doctor Who, Michael Grade.
I didn't know that. That's interesting.
I think so. I'm just trying to type it in, but my computer's
slow. Because they were very anti-science fiction.
Yes, he was. Yeah, he was.
I think he would be at Destruction of Blake 7, I think, because they just come in at the time, I think. Because they got rid of a lot of it off there, you know. He wanted to go to all these, like, shows and all this and... You know, he made the decision to move it to Wednesday night against Coronation.
Here we are. I found it. Sorry to interrupt you. Here we are. It says, if you're upset about Colin Baker's time as the Doctor, it wasn't all good, and about how he was treated, you need to know that neither he or John Nathan Turner had anything to do with it. So stand by the read and learn the truth behind the Doctor Who period. The reason Colin Baker had such a short tenure was because Michael Grade absolutely hated him. And also having an affair with Colin's estranged wife. If not for Grade, the show would have run several seasons longer. So apparently, Michael Grade had an affair with Colin Baker's estranged wife.
Hang on a minute. So what, Michael Grade was having an affair with Colin Baker's wife?
Yeah, that's what it says. Ooh. And this is what I remember. This is why I remember something about it. And this is confirming what I said to you. He had an affair.
Although
they were estranged, so it sounds like they weren't that close at that point anyway. But so that's a purely personal factor rather than the show itself.
So really, they got rid of it because they were in it. That's who wanted him out, didn't it? And that was it, wasn't it?
Yeah, and then of course they
got that.
And that's why he left and didn't come back for the regeneration. And then after that, he really got his claws into the show by this point. And unfortunately, poor Sylvester McCoy couldn't save it. There we go. Right. So you've learned some facts today.
Well, I didn't know that, mate. Honestly, I didn't know that.
I heard about that ages ago, and it suddenly, as we were talking, it suddenly went ping in my head, and then I just thought, let's look it up. And like I said, this, wherever this site is, it's sort of saying what I was aware of previously, that there was something there. So it says here, so for those of you who blame Colin Baker for the period as the Doctor not being the greatest, and now know the dark truth behind that era of the programme. So, yeah, it was all to do with Michael Grade, and it was a personal issue between Michael Grade, Colin Baker, and his estranged wife. Yeah.
Well, then I will take back some of the things I've said, and I will sit on the fence, and I may watch some Colin Baker over the next few weeks.
I think so, because it wasn't all his fault. And yes, he wore a bit of a stupid thing, but I think in some regards, it's not all his fault, and you should give him a benefit of the doubt.
He did release a single to save Doctor Who.
Oh, shall we put that on as the end song?
Think that's it. You might do it. He was on Top of the Pops.
Doctor in Distress. It's terrible.
That's it, yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's the song for the show. At the end of this, which is so fitting, we'll put in that song. Sorry, people, but it's all Marty's fault, so blame him. No, I'm just joking.
Oh, blame him. I've just backed down.
I know. I'm only joking. I think that's really funny. But yeah, I think that's very interesting. Any other factors you want to talk about with this particular era of Doctor Who?
I think that's it. I think we've covered it. I remember Perry in the bikini.
Oh, God, I know. I liked her.
They'll never forget that.
I know. And I remember Peter Davison saying that his regeneration, all he could do was look at her cleavage.
Yeah. Because I was young at the time. I was a young man at the time.
Oh, don't. I know. Happy days.
I met Colin Baker. I met them both at Norcon about 4 or 5 years
ago. I think he's a really nice guy, actually. He strikes me as a really nice guy.
I know. He was wonderful. And she were really nice. They were both 30.
Nicola Brandt's nice as well. And it's I remember him saying that he's never watched the regeneration scene with Sylvester McCoy, who basically just wore his wig of his hair. I think he found it just a bit too upsetting, because he was a big Doctor Who fan. He's a big Doctor Who fan. He wanted to be in Doctor Who, and he actually appeared as a member of someone from Gallifrey in a Peter Davison episode.
Yeah, he was in the High Guard, wasn't he? He was in the Gallifreyan Guard.
So we had seen him before.
He was in Blake 7 as this manic villain. He was great in leather. He was like this insane Babe and the Butcher, it was called.
I've got to watch it. I've got all the Blake 7s, but I've not watched them all yet. I'm going to watch them all at some point. Again, it's something I mean to do. But what we'll do is, in the future, if we're focusing on a show which we haven't seen recently, then I'll try to completely catch up, and then we can have a big discussion. Like Blake 7, I'll do that. When we get near there, give me a week, definitely. And I'll try and go through them all, so that at least we can have a proper conversation. Right, I think that's it for now. Let's move on then to the infamous Predator Versus, and here's the jingle. Here we go.
Predator Versus.
Apes together, strong!
Right then, Martin, tell me who it is all about. It's all over to you.
Well, I was thinking about this. I was speaking to my friend the other night, and he said, I don't know, got onto the Waltons, and I went off.
That's right, you told me about that.
I watched like some clips of fucking Waltons, and I found out all this like stuff about them, that the want was clean cut is what you thought. Well, I'm not going to mention it on air, but I was surprised, right?
Oh, you mean the actors, you mean? Yeah.
And I thought Predator versus the Waltons, but I've got to work that out, but I've got the scenario. So this week, Predator versus Planet of the Apes. Now, I'm going to let you choose either two of the characters, General Ursus from the films or General Oko from the TV series. You can choose one.
Oh, let's go with the TV series, because he would have had more on-screen time.
Yes, General Oko. I was hoping you'd go there. Perfect.
Good.
Right. Let's start.
Go for it.
Right, Predator is flying through space and sees a ship. It's several light years ahead, but there's a temporal storm from the ship. It's creating this wake, and it knocks the ship off course. And suddenly Predator crashes on a planet with no moon.
Okay.
It's
Okay.
In the Forbidden Zone near New York City.
Right.
Meanwhile, somebody's looking for two astronauts and an ape, and he's had permission from Dr. Zayas to go in the Forbidden Zone.
Right.
As him and five apes. Burden, Burke and Galen have, like, they've ended up being caught by the Underdwellers, right? Them at the, like, the TV, I'm just making this up, like the TV equivalent, if they exist, right?
Yeah.
And they're trapped there. But Urko's on loose. They see this light in the sky, like, crashing. So him and his five apes, guerrilla soldiers, he sends three of his men over to go and investigate from the camp, because they're camping out in the valley, in the Forbidden Zone. And they get there, and he doesn't hear anything from them. But so he goes riding off, him and the other ape, and he sees three dead bodies on the floor, and they've been stripped.
Oh, okay.
You know, they've had the spines ripped out, and it stood on a ridge as a predator, stood in air with a spear, and one of the apes said, and Urko can't believe it. So the predator turns invisible and it starts stalking Urko. And Urko's got all his ape gear on. The predator takes out his horse, it blows the horse's head off with a laser bolt. Urko's okay. Other gorilla got the gun, starts shooting, but he runs out of bullets. He gets vaporized, just Urko left. Right. Now he's got a sword as Urko and he's got his gun. And because they're slightly physically stronger than what we are, the predator moves in for the kill. But Urko, because he's trained in certain combat techniques, he went to the Ape Academy. He's a top soldier. And he realizes that if he goes and hides amongst the rock, because there's a lot of water, and he starts sneaking through this waterfall, the predator's like walking through water, and Urko sees him.
Okay.
And he throws himself. He gets this bit like he climbs up this top, and he throws himself into a gorilla rage. But the predator's fired a dart at him and it's at his legs, so Urko's up there. But he manages to do, like, he gets these rocks and he pushes the rocks off the waterfall. Load of rocks crash onto the predator.
Right.
And suddenly all electrical shocks going off, and it starts throwing its armor off and it can't turn invisible. And its weapons aren't working. So anyway, Urko jumps into water and fucking lays into him. I mean, he's really going at it, because he's General Urko.
Yeah, and he's
tearing this thing apart. Predator fucking stabs him inside of his stomach, and Urko's like stood there, gets his gun, unloads several like bullets into Predator. And then he finds like an ape machine gun coming from one of the dead apes, and he blasts it with machine gun, runs out of bullets. And suddenly Urko realised, he's like, he just stands up and he pulls his sword out and he's going, fuck this, you know, you know, human scum, you know, whatever you are, you're worse than human scum, right? And he goes in, fucking big fight, and he chops the predator's head. He just suddenly is like, it's big fight, and it's all in slow motion.
Yeah.
And Urko, he knocks him in bollocks. Again, we go back to the
two
bollocks.
Two predator bollocks, yeah.
Banging the bollocks and passing around. And he lifts the predator up and he throws into the water and he gets his sword. He jumps up like an ape and just fucking smacks the sword into his heart and like twists it and kills the predator.
Oh.
And he carries the predator's head off. Blood all over Urko. He's like, all over. And he lifts its head up going, fuck you. Do you know what I mean? Ape power. Power to the ape. And then just over at Red, there's another patrol of apes turn up.
Right.
You know? And that's it. It's like, they're all stood there going, you all right, General? And he's like, yeah, I don't know what the fuck this was, but it's a creature in the Forbidden Zone, because they don't understand space.
No, exactly, yeah, of course not. They just think it's
a mutant. And Predator's dead. You know, it just decapitated. Can't even set the blood. So Urko said, burn the body, just destroy everything.
Yeah, which they do. They always just destroy anything which doesn't indicate their sort of intelligent civilizations, which aren't theirs, which they've done it with.
Okay. He goes back to Ape City and reports to Zayas, right?
Right.
And he tells Zayas what happens, and Zayas orders the execution of the five apes that saved him.
Oh, as witness.
He said to Urko, he said, 1,000 years ago, these creatures were coming to this planet when man ruled the world, but we could never let them know.
Oh, and that's how it is. So they know about it from their historical...
From
I
the
like
ancient
that.
Chronicles,
yeah,
yes.
Yeah, that's really good thinking. No, I love that. Well done. Yeah, that's it.
Thank you very much.
No, I like that. I like the fact that they're known to the apes. Yeah, that's good. Yeah, I like that. That's good.
Okay.
That's good.
The test.
Yeah, you have. You have. No, I like that. Yeah. That's good. I can see that working, actually. That would be really interesting.
I just
interesting.
Made all that up now.
I normally do it with mine, like I said. But he just, when you start doing these stories and you start, suddenly you just go off on these tangents and think, oh, that'll work, that'll work. Well done. Well, next week it's the Waltons again, so you're up to bat next week. No. I'm sorry you brought it up now, so I think that might take a bit more work to say, but I'm definitely going to...
It will do. Yeah. There is some military statistics with the Waltons.
Is there?
Yeah. Well, number one, the hillbillies, so they've got guns. Number two, Pa Walton was in the First World War, and two of the sons were in the Second World War.
So they've had some experience of battle and stuff. Okay.
Yeah, and they know the environment of Walton's Mountain.
Okay. Well, listen, Martin...
It'd be like Deliverance meets Predator.
Oh, that's another one to do. Oh, no, I could do Deliverance, though. I love Deliverance. Oh. It's a good film. I only saw that the other week, actually, Deliverance again. It's a really good film.
Is that bird, man?
Yeah, it's very, very good film. We'll have to get you seeing that one. But yeah, thank you for that. Brilliant show. Really interesting. So you've learned a bit about the Sixth Doctor, Colin Baker. I've thought that was a great idea. Yeah, so when you look back on that show, give it a little bit more of a benefit of the doubt that it was not all...
Seriously.
Go for it, mate. All right, well, listen, on that note, we shall sign off. I want to leave this week with Doctor in Distress, which was this charity song thing that a lot of stars got involved singing, trying to get Doctor Who back on, because it was on hiatus for 18 months, I think it was. It's not the best song in the world, but it suits this episode, it suits sci-fi, and that's what we're going to leave it with. So, Martin, catch you next week. Thank you again. Everybody stay safe out there, and we'll catch you next week on the Solo on Sci-Fi podcast. Live long and prosper. Laters.
And a mouthful.